Welcome once again to Cinemaholics, the major motion podcast, where we talk about the biggest and the best films coming to theaters and streaming online. From the San Francisco Bay Area, I'm John Agroni, film editor for InBetweenDrafts.com. And from Pittsburgh, Pennsylvania, he's your best friend. He's pairing with you right now, and he's always going to be looking out for you. When you need a news and entertainment writer at Collider, Will Ashton will be there for you.
What up?
It's Will Ashton.
What up, John? My friend, my comrade, my brother in Christ. How you doing?
You're creeping me out, Will. Did you murder all of those people just to protect me?
I can neither confirm nor deny.
This week we're talking about M3GAN, and it's a miracle we're able to get to this movie.
A mega
because a what?
I was going to say a Megan goal, but that...
A Megan goal?
I don't know. It didn't even work in my head, and I was like, I'm just going to go for it.
I'm fine with you shooting the shot.
Yeah.
You know what? Sometimes you shoot the shot, and it actually works out.
Sure.
So I'm always... You're hunting. You're chasing that dream.
Yeah, you know? You got to go for it sometimes.
Yeah, man. I wasn't sure how we were going to be able to talk about this one, because I missed my screening, and I missed the big opening rollout of this movie, right? Because Bay Area, we've just been getting hit with all these storms, and I haven't been wanting to travel. I mean, when it rains here, it's like, imagine a blizzard, you know, like anywhere else, basically.
Are you saying that when it rains, it pours?
It pours.
Yeah.
Yeah, we're not equipped in the Bay Area for rain. It's just like flooding and everywhere, and it's like really dangerous. People aren't used to driving in the rain. I'm from Virginia. I know how to do it, but it's... Yeah, even our roads are even slicker, you know, because it's just a different chemical compound. Anyway,
yeah.
Point is, I just watched M3GAN. Mm. So did you.
Yeah.
We just watched it. And this is like fresh off the presses for us.
Yeah, and this is one of the rare times where, you know, we didn't really plan it out. But we both kind of watched it at the same time, albeit, you know, not the same
theater. We didn't. We literally didn't know until we both were like, oh, yeah, I'm about to watch M3GAN. Oh, yeah, me too. And like literally, not just the same time, like, oh, Will watched it at night, John watched it. No, we literally like the same like half hour.
Yeah, we didn't synchronize. I actually thought you were watching this film before me, like you were going to see it earlier in the day. But your afternoon is my evening. And so it just kind of worked out that we saw it. You know, at the same time, we got to experience M3GAN anew and together.
Yeah.
Albeit not in the same place in the same time.
A lot of, and you know what? How could we miss it? It's such an event.
Sure, I guess.
M3GAN, the first major release of 2023. Mm-hmm. You know, some people might say, oh, no, excuse me, that was A Man Called Otto.
Yes.
Which actually made more money at the box office than I was expecting. I was expecting it to be like a couple mil. But I think it made some upwards of like, it might have hit 10. Let me double check that. But
I mean,
yeah.
I don't know. I mean, Avatar was like, you know what? People, they rediscovered their love of cinema, I think. They went to the movies and they're like, what else you got? And they're like, we got Babylon. It's like, well, I'm not going to see that. But what else do you got? And it's like, well, we got Puss in Boots. We got Man Called Otto. And we got a movie called M3GAN.
Right. Which you still haven't seen A Man Called Otto, which is why we're not talking about it.
I am seeing it tomorrow.
Yeah, maybe we'll talk about it later.
Yeah.
But I just checked. I made $12.7 million worldwide. Most of that's international.
Mm-hmm.
Only a pittance of that is domestic. So it's not like I mean, look, Sony got this movie for like $60 million to acquire it. Mm-hmm. I don't know how that's going to play out there.
I don't know.
But otherwise, it's not doing terribly.
Yeah, I mean, I don't want to delay because I know you have a time crunch. And I don't want to dilly-dally because I know the listeners want to hear our thoughts on M3GAN.
They want to know. They're tired. I wanted to set it up because, I mean, M3GAN, to what I was saying, this is this year's Scream. Big horror January movie that a lot of people are like, I got to go see this.
Was Scream the first release of the year? Like, it was like not the first horror movie.
I don't think it was the very first of the 2022, but I mean, I think it was like kind of similar to this, like maybe the second weekend, I want to say. I'm not 100%, I don't remember 100% sure, but it was very much like the first big movie, you know, that wasn't like an award season kind of thing.
Yeah, but I mean, historically, I mean, at least in the past decade or so, that first weekend of January has been a big push for whatever new horror movie. Usually, though, it's they kind of dump something and it's just like, well, we can make a good bit of cash the opening weekend, and then people realize the movie stinks, and then it kind of withers away. But M3GAN seems like it's going to actually have, at least by these early estimations, who knows what's going to happen next week and the week after, but it does seem like it's going to have some cultural pull, which is pretty rare.
Two years, that's the thing, man. 2 years in a row, a decent, if not good, if not great horror movie, at least in the public consciousness, has reclaimed January, because January is, as you're referencing, it's notoriously been a dumping ground. Mm-hmm. That's when movies like Slender Man or Bye Bye Man, whatever, man, kinds of movies would hit January. Most people wouldn't see them. It was always sort of like an indication that the movie wasn't going to be successful for whatever reason. Maybe I think what it could have been is a couple of those horror movies actually did like way better than expected, because people were like, well, nothing else going on, nothing else to watch, it's cold outside. And these studios were like, money on the table. I mean, people are watching movies, the behaviors are changing. January doesn't have to necessarily be, you know, undercooked in terms of what we can put out there. And I think the two kinds of movies that have been successful in January consistently have been movies like Megan, Scream, but also A Man Called Otto, which is, you know, we'll talk about it then. But I mean, very much something kind of like The Upside, like an American remake of a European kind of just drama movie that was made for, you know, not that, but kind of mid-budget, that sort of thing. But in terms of Megan, the internet has been like, they rolled out the red carpet for Megan. Mm. They couldn't wait for her to show up.
Yeah, I mean, it's been a big success story for the marketing of the film. Primarily, I guess,
the marketing has just nailed it.
I mean, I think this movie, I mean, maybe there's been another film that has kind of capitalized this, I'm not exactly sure, at least intentionally, has been able to kind of seep its way into TikTok culture and really take
Smile
off.
Was the other one. Smile, I think, was a pretty good prototype for figuring out like what will get like attention, you know, and will appeal to people who have TikTok like attention spans. You know what I mean? Not even just literally advertising on TikTok, because all the movie studios do that, but it goes beyond that, right? It's about creating the viral moments that can be shared anywhere.
I mean, TikTok is still obviously a very new social media platform, but if you want to see like night and day as far as like effective TikTok marketing versus ineffective TikTok marketing, look at the marketing for Megan and then look at the TikTok marketing for Babylon.
yeah, where it's like, you know, cropped funny, doesn't make any sense. And yeah, I mean, a lot of people have been commenting these past couple of months, and we've talked about it a little bit, of how movie marketing has felt a little bit like a wild, wild west. Nobody knows what's going on. Nobody knows what's really going to work. It all feels really mythical. Like, who knows what appeals to the kids? They made a whole Texas Chainsaw movie that was supposed to appeal to Gen Z, and no one could have cared. And so it is interesting to see that some people are figuring it out. We should note, by the way, as we're kind of setting up this movie, director Gerard Johnstone, who's like an indie director, didn't watch their first movie, which was Housebound, I think it was called. Wasn't it? This is a New Zealand director.
Oh, I saw Housebound. Yeah.
You did? Was it? Well, I've heard it's good.
Yeah, it's not bad.
2014,
yeah,
right?
Yeah, I saw that one.
Okay. And I think this is... seems like a different kind of movie altogether, but the screenplay is from Akela Cooper. Story credit goes to her and to James Wan, we should say. But yeah, I'm kind of curious. Well, I mean, look, I didn't watch the trailer with everybody else, but it seemed like people were like, Megan, let's go. As soon as that trailer came out, people were like, oh my gosh, I got to see this. It looks like a horror comedy up my alley. Were you kind of on that train? Did you watch the trailer? Have you been hotly anticipating this?
Yeah, I've been with it. I was going to say, I mean, I haven't seen the trailer for Megan like before every film I've seen of late, but I've seen it a lot because, I've seen a lot of movies recently and it's come up fairly often. It seems like of all the gluttony of trailers that have come out, you know, especially when you go to an AMC and you get 20 minutes of trailers, Megan's kind of the one that usually provokes some sort of reaction from the crowd, whether it's sort of like a goffing, like, what is this kind of thing? Or if it's like, oh, this looks so silly and fun, I have to see this. It just seemed like Megan was actually provoking these responses in a way that, like, you know, you'll see 8 out of 10 trailers and people just watch it stone face and then the next one comes on. But no, I mean, Megan kind of...
Okay, there's the Ant-Man trailer. Yeah, exactly. Okay. Yeah. And then Megan comes on and people are getting out of their seats and clapping.
Yeah, I mean, I don't know. It's not like they're like trained SEALs, but, you know, like they're... you know, it's clearly like, what is this? This looks dumb, but I have to see it. Or like, it looks dumb and I, you know, don't want to see it all. It provoked a reaction. I didn't want to like place a firm bet on it because we are in Avatar season and Avatar is just, you know, dominating in terms of box office. But if I were a betting man, I would have said, yeah, Megan looks like it has a decent chance of making an impression at the box office.
It's already made $45.7 million. Yeah. And I think a lot of that is, if anything, is thanks to Avatar. Avatar is bringing people out to the theater.
Sure.
It's making them want to go back to the movies after watching Avatar the second time. Mm. And it's great counter programming. Cool. We just watched Avatar. That was super long. Let's watch something else. Oh, let's not watch something as long. You know, let's watch something a little bit different. This is like that kind of movie, right? I think that's why horror tends to play so well in January, because people in December, people are used to like maybe it's the big Star Wars movie, a big Disney movie, whatever. It's like the big all family, all ages thing. January's for the adults, man. The adults, the teens, and everybody in betweens.
I don't know if I would say it's for the adults, but I mean, is there anything
Megan's for adults?
No, I mean they actually went so far as to knock it down to a PG-13 to appeal more.
Well,
to
that's
teenagers.
True, and yeah. I think because they understand that this is the kind of movie that like yes. they want teenagers to go to. Literally, like my screening, there was like teenagers came in dressed as Megan. It was kind of like the Gentle Minions thing. I think I've heard that that's been happening at some theaters, and
yeah,
it's extensively creepy. But no, but the story appeals, I think, to millennials, to adults. Like it's a story very much about millennials, even though it is appealing or trying to appeal to Gen Z. But I mean, that's not terribly weird, is it? Because like there are plenty of movies that have been marketed to millennials, like you and me, mm-hmm. but were about baby boomers. Like what's Top Gun Maverick? Like you know what I mean?
Yeah, I mean. My main concern, I guess, going into fall, if I had any real concerns as far as Megan is concerned.
I have a lot of concerns about Megan myself.
Sure. Is that it seemed a little premature about like the memeage and about like its cultural status. Like it just seemed like the type of film
like
that was
being
almost
forced upon us, like yeah. a little manufactured.
Oh, it just kind of seemed like it was like trying a little hard to be like, this is our next, you know, slasher queen icon, you know.
But everybody responded like, You want this to happen? Fine. Do it. Let's go. I think everybody was on the same page, though. I just see a lot of people who were like, this is extensively creepy.
Yeah.
And they were responding to the marketing as like, you got us.
Sure. And I mean, that wasn't me like being concerned in the sense of like, I didn't think it was going to live up to it. I was just like, it seems like we're kind of putting the cart before the horse here. Mm-hmm. But, you know, like I was excited when the reviews are coming in. They're good. We'll talk about the reviews later, obviously. But yeah, I mean, it seemed like, you know, I was just a little concerned that we were getting, you know, a kind of premature excitement. But at the same time,
I get what you mean. I was worried that the hype was going to throw me off.
But at the same time, it was exciting to see, you know, all this building excitement for a film because, you know, so many movies now have been so, you know, lackluster in terms of audience in box office. It's just like, okay, like clearly it's, you know, building anticipation for this movie. It's going to, you know, get people to go to the theaters, you know, that there's nothing wrong with that. It's very exciting. And it gets that, you know, it stabilizes the theaters again, like you said, because of Avatar and all that. And so, yeah, I mean, but in the grand scheme of things, I was excited for Megan to answer your initial question.
The movie stars Allison Williams. This is, I think, you know, kind of completing her trilogy of millennial final girl movies.
Okay. Girls?
They include Get Out.
Okay.
The Perfection.
Sure.
And now Megan.
Okay. I didn't know if you were going to put Girls in that lineup or not.
Well, no, she's not a final girl in Girls.
No,
I
know.
I mean, I never finished the show, but did it take a turn for
no,
the horror?
No, but if you're going to talk about, like, you know, millennial art, I feel like people are kind of really recognizing that Girls is like a show that really, I feel like, defined this era in a way that I feel like people are finally now appreciating.
Okay.
Yeah.
There was another movie she was in called Horizon Line from 2020.
That's the plane
with Keith
one, right?
David. Yes.
Yeah. I saw a trailer.
I don't
for that.
Think that one counts.
Yeah. I don't think that counts.
That feels like an outlier.
Sure.
Yeah. Because I think for this trilogy to work, more than 10 people had to have watched it.
Yeah.
So
I mean, did that many people watch Perfection? I liked The Perfection, but did that many people
watch
it? It
was on Netflix.
Sure.
I feel like, yeah, The Perfection made more of like an impact.
Sure.
You know, at least impact adjacent.
I mean,
but
the big thing about
I
this
like
one,
a lot.
Though, is that it's her returning to Blumhouse for the first time since Get Out.
That's right. That's right. Because Perfection, like we said, Netflix. And I think before that, Miramax was the company before. Something happened with Miramax, and you'll have to fill in the blanks yourself for that.
Oh, yeah.
But
what's going on there?
what happened to Miramax? But, you know, so Allison Williams, she's the lead of this movie. I mean, she's one of the really the most, you know, well-known actor in this. You know, also Ronnie Chang, who, you know, Netflix stand-up comedian. He's been in some stuff,
sure.
Daily Show, people recognize him from, but not like a terribly star-studded movie, right?
No.
I know people like Violet McGraw, but...
Sure, but I mean, Megan's the star here, let's be real.
Yeah.
And, yeah, I mean, that's all you need. It's Megan. It's a movie about Megan. Megan's the star. you got what you came for, you know.
The movie, as we've alluded to, it, you know, Allison Williams plays this young woman. I mean, older than us, I guess. Like, she's in, what, her mid-30s? She's like a, not an elder millennial, but kind of like middle millennial to elder, somewhere in that zone. And
you are she's really claiming this is a millennial film, to be clear. Like, I don't know.
I think it is. I think it's
a millennial. Okay, I'm just saying, like, I mean, I wasn't anticipating you, like, going all in on this is a film for the millennials here.
It is.
Sure, yeah, I mean, if you want it to be. Whatever.
I'll explain everything, sure. You know, just give me a chance. Give me an honest chance here. So Allison Williams, you know, there's this terrible tragedy that happens to her niece. She's in a car accident. She loses her parents. And so she has to take her niece in and basically have to start raising her as her guardian. But she doesn't feel like she's equipped to that. Also, she happens to work at a toy company. So she makes robots and codes and stuff like that. And she finds a way to take this invention, this prototype that she's been working on. She thinks it's the future of toys. A doll that's like life size and that can actually have like artificial intelligence and respond to a child and be really smart and be a great, like basically a babysitter. And she decides to test out this new invention on her niece to try to help her cope with the death of her parents. But as you can imagine in this kind of movie, it's borrowing from things like Child's Play, like Orphan, you know, this kind of thing where maybe it's not so great to have robots raise children. You know, it's a pretty decent enough premise. That's kind of where the movie finds its footing there. I have a few notes on this. I have a lot to say, Will, but I got to get your initial impression here, because I know you're still hot off the movie. I am too. But overall, did you like it?
Oh, I had fun, man. I had a good time. You know?
I had fun.
Yeah, I had a lot of fun. Yeah, I mean,
I left and I had a smile on my face walking out.
Yeah, I mean, it's one of those films where as soon as like the first scene happens, and I won't give it away because I think everyone should just experience it on their own. But that opening scene just kind of puts you in like a warm blanket as far as like, this is what the tone of the film is going to be. Here's what you can expect. You're going to be in good hands. Just have fun. And yeah, I mean, you know, it's I think it has to walk a very fine line as far as like being self-aware, but not being too winking to the point where it doesn't really sell the premise. You know,
the movie's not as self-aware as M3GAN. Is what you're saying?
Well, no, I mean, I am saying it's self-aware. I'm just saying that...
Well, you're saying it's not too self-aware. That's what
no,
I'm saying,
No, what I'm
right?
saying is, like, it's not too cutesy about being self-aware.
I see.
Yeah, like, if it's too...
Because it can't be, but it's not rubbing your face in
yeah.
it.
Yeah, and I think, you know, it's not, like, bombastic in terms of style. Like, it's when you say campy, it's not, like, super, like, over the top and goofy the whole time. Like, it plays it mostly...
It's not flamboyant all the time,
yeah,
no.
It plays it generally straight, but it's obviously, like, playing it with, like, a knowing grin, but not, like, winking at you the whole time as it's happening. And obviously, it's kind of playing into, like you said, like, this idea of, like, oh, let's trust technology, but technology can't always be trusted. A moral that we've seen however many times in movies and media before this. But... yeah, I mean, at the same time, like you have directors here, or you have a director here who knows how to balance that tone. You have writers and producers, particularly James Wan, then I can't remember his name, but the main screenwriter for Malignant,
Akela Cooper. Yeah. She I love her work. I think she's a tremendous talent.
I don't know if there's like a lot you have to say about M3GAN, because I think it kind of just speaks for itself. But you seem to disagree. I know you have a lot to say about it. I don't want to like step on your toes too much. I just want you to kind of say your piece, and then we can get more into the nitty gritty of the film.
I mean, the main thing for me is that I think this movie surprised me in some ways that are really interesting. Like, for one thing, you know, you mentioned like the opening, the cold open, how we get introduced to this world, and right off the bat, I knew, oh, this is. The writing here is definitely not just going to be as cookie cutter as maybe some people might expect when they walk into this. Specifically, I really love how the human characters are flawed in unlikable ways. Even the parents are unlikable. Like, when we get to know them, like, the movie doesn't start off where, you know, the kid is just like, oh my gosh, my life is perfect. And her parents are like, you're right, baby doll. We're perfect parents. Death. Like, this isn't, you know, that kind of like
right.
warm sort of thing, because it's not going to try to do that and then try to make you feel overwhelmingly sad for this mm-hmm. girl. You still feel sad for her because you're just like, oh my gosh.
Oh, sure, it's
like,
tragic.
But if anything, you feel more like Allison Williams' character, where you're like, man, yeah, life is tough. that's the emotion that the movie is keying in on. And I think that's what I'm getting at, where I think this is, it feels like the DNA of Akela Cooper's writing, which is very much of like leading you into emotional states that are not exactly what you expect. Because as we get to know these characters, like the kid who's played, as I mentioned before, by Violet McGraw, she, I think she's the sister of another young actress that was in the movie.
Who's in the Black Phone.
That's right. Yes. Black Phone.
Another Blumhouse production.
Another Blumhouse movie. It's like, it's almost like the people in Hollywood know each other, Nepo babies and all that. Allison Williams, Nepo baby. She had a great response to that when somebody asked her about it. Probably the only good response anyone's had. Anyway, you get to know these characters, and like even the kid, Katie, like she's kind of a brat. She's like, her parents are like trying to deal with something, and she's kind of being annoying to them. The mom is like nagging the dad is like being condescending to the mom. Like, it kind of comes off as just like, ah, they're just people, you know, they kind of suck. And that's the note that we start off on. And you could totally see a different version of this movie where like all the character arcs, if it would all be so robotic, for lack of a pun. But it isn't. I think it actually is like something a little bit, I don't want to say it's smart, but it's smarter, if that makes sense.
Yeah, I mean, you could say it's like clever about it, but it's not like being
cunning and sharp.
Yeah, I mean, I don't want to say it's like, I mean, it's obviously being cutesy about it. But it's not being overly cutesy about it, which I think is kind
of
the key.
Cerebral. It's not cerebral. This isn't Ari Aster. It's not pretentious.
Yeah, I mean, yeah, it's like I said, it's kind of walking that fine line where it's like, it's giving you what you expect from this premise and the story. It's like kind of playing similar beats, but it's also, like you said, kind of fleshing them out, as it were, in a way that feels a little bit more robust and a little bit more evolved, I guess, to keep the pun game going.
Yeah, because like you don't have these moments where, for example, you know, like where, okay, the parents die, you expect that. And like usually what these movies try to do is they would take the Allison Williams character and they would kind of just put her on just like, you know, where she's wearing like a really cozy sweater and she's looking out the window with her knuckles right up against her jaw. And she's just like, how am I going to raise this kid? But instead, it's just way more emotionally intelligent where she's just like, I don't know, like what, kid, can you play with this iPad? Like, I don't know, this, that entire time I was feeling it because that is so millennial. And also like the whole point of this movie, right, is Allison Williams, I think, is a kind of like, it's a new kind of scream queen that does what scream queens used to do more reliably, which is really reflect the current time. And I think that a lot of like the scream queens of like the 90s and the early aughts, they kind of got away from this because I think that everything got so generic. It got so wishy-washy and bland. This feels more honed in. This feels more of like, okay, let's look at a millennial white woman who kind of rejects traditional norms. In this case, parenting and the social anxiety of like, am I ever going to be could I be a good parent? Maybe I shouldn't be. I'm more focused on my career. Like that kind of thing, right?
Yeah, avoiding.
Which is something that is, like people our age kind of take this for granted, but that's a very new phenomenon for it to be as widespread and as mainstream and normalized as it is.
Yeah, I mean, it is kind of fascinating also that like the film doesn't really ever explore like her ever settling down or like even her sexuality or anything like that. It's just like she's so head focused in her career that like her personal life is non-existent basically.
And she doesn't feel all that bad about it, nor, and the movie doesn't say she should.
Right. That's what I mean. It's not judging.
But there is still
her
an anxiety there. And I think that's what's smart about it, because it's a movie that understands that a lot of people make that decision for themselves and they don't regret that decision at all to decide, you know what, I'm not going to have kids. I'm not going to settle down. And everyone says I should. And the movie isn't saying like, oh, you should feel bad about that. It's not preachy or anything. But it is saying that there is an inherent anxiety there for where, what if parenting is then thrust upon you in your mid-30s when you don't expect it? You know, it could be an unplanned pregnancy. Unfortunately, it could be a tragedy like this. And what that does to you, of like how it's so jarring, how you don't know how to handle and cope with it. And like, this is like way more emotionally gripping than I thought the movie M3GAN was going to be.
Yeah, I mean, I think that's kind of been the key though for the better Blumhouse productions, right? Is that they try to, you know, take what people expect from these kind of popcorn horror films, but they also expand upon them, play with genre and tone in a way that, you know, elevates the genre, as it were, not to play into like the whole elevated horror phenomenon. But yeah, I mean, in a way that like, you know, obviously it's like the next step in horror. And I think the weaker Blumhouse movies just kind of play it safe and predictable. But the ones I prefer, the ones I think that really stand out and pop, like this one or like Happy Death Day or like we said before, Get Out, are kind of evolving the genre in a way that it is familiar in some respects, but also feels very fresh and inviting and new. And it's just that balance of commercial fun, but also doing something that is a little bit smarter, a little bit more clever than you might expect going into it.
Right. The commercial fun is that I am afraid of what this movie is kind of saying in its subtext. Not even in its subtext. It's pretty overt, actually. But like, you could easily make an argument for, okay, this movie is about how millennials are afraid of Gen Z. You know, even more broadly, they're afraid of the next generation. The next generation is as scary as the character of Megan, a character that is super plugged into like technology. You disagree?
Well, is she Gen Z or is she more alpha?
I think. You could kind of blur the lines there.
Sure.
That's why I said more broadly the next generation, like the generation coming up. It doesn't have to be Gen Z, but it can be, you know, essentially like any sort of like young, like extremely tech savvy, raised on technology, in this case, an actual robot. So like Megan stands for Model 3 Generated Android or something. And it is like a very, you know, it is a very scary thing to sort of grapple with, like what the future means and like where technology is going and all of that, and how that can make you feel insecure as like your place in the world, right? Because a lot of this movie is the Allison Williams character being like, well, what use am I? Like this doll is better at raising the kid than I am. And I kind of like that that's the case.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I mean, it's not, I mean, obviously, like we see throughout the film that like she's very pro-tech, and then like her sister was kind of more, you know, critical of technology. It's kind of acknowledging that like, yeah, like technology's not going to go away. You can't just like, you know, raise your kids away from screen time and all that stuff, but also acknowledging that like, yeah, you can't like expect a machine to raise your child, in this case, you know, quite literally.
Right.
And yeah, I mean, I think that's kind of the fun of it, is that like it's taking this very familiar premise of like, you know, the robot gone bad scenario, but giving it a very kind of modern, timely lens without making that, you know, too overt or like taking out the fun of it.
Exactly. It's a fresh coat of paint for a very fun trope, very fun genre. And I'm glad you brought that up because, yeah, it should be pointed out that the Allison Williams character, she is very tech savvy. She created the doll. Like, millennials are tech savvy. Like, we know the internet. We were raised on it too. But it's just showing that, like, oh my gosh, like this, you know, this doll that looks like one of the Olsen twins is basically more tech savvy than I am. And that is kind of like a little freaky. Like, it's a little bit like, it's unsettling is what it is. But it's never like super annoyingly, you know, unsettling, I guess. But yeah. And also, I did want to bring up the comedy of it, because if I had one sort of, not disappointment, but one sort of thing where I was a little bit like, huh, it's that I actually didn't find the movie as funny as I expected it would be. I thought I'd be laughing a lot. I chuckled. I thought it was very lighthearted in certain parts, and I liked jokes in it and stuff, but it wasn't like a full-on horror comedy, right? It kind of takes itself pretty seriously.
I don't know. I was laughing. I wasn't like, you know.
I wasn't laughing much.
I wasn't like, you know, like, like the whole time, but you know, I was like, I was laughing,
busting a gut.
I was like, you know, I was having good time.
I was smiling, I was shaking my head and being like, oh, Megan.
Yeah, but no, I mean, Megan. I was gonna ask you though. I mean, maybe we can touch on this a little bit later when we talk more about like the ending. But how did you feel about the movie kind of getting more kind of quippy and like, you know, Megan being a little bit more kind of like self-aware comedically as the film went along?
Because it would have worked way better if it was R-rated.
Well, that's my, yeah, I mean,
that's the big shortcoming.
Yeah, I mean, I assume that this was conceived as like an R-rated film, and then they kind of like kangaroo jacked it a little bit as the post-production went along. And I felt like,
because there's certain scenes in here where you're like, oh, they probably like had that all set up to like show you like how gruesome that is.
Yeah,
and you don't get to see that.
I mean, there's like one particular scene towards the middle where it's like, it's obviously a very violent thing, but it seemed like there was like supposed to be a very like large, like kind of crunching noise that's supposed to happen, and it's just quiet, and it feels very odd. Like, it's like, okay, they must have tinkered this a little bit to, you know, get that back to a PG-13. And I'm not like opposed to, you know, PG-13 slashers on principle. As I mentioned before, I really did enjoy Happy Death Day. And I think that movie actually works around the R rating really effectively. Like, I think that movie, it's so much about Tree's life through these, like, this death cycle, and the fact that she's, you know, finding herself is actually benefited by not really showing all these gruesome death scenes, because it doesn't sensationalize her journey, her trauma. But I feel like with this movie, even though it is also about grief and trauma, it is kind of needing that lack of humanity from Megan. Like, she needs to kind of have that very deep brutality and that lack of empathy. It feels a little shortcutted by making it PG-13 over R, and clearly working around these sort of violent circumstances that she does, and what's meant to be kind of more over the top than actually is here.
Yeah, that's what surprised me more than anything else. And we haven't even touched on it, but this is really like a sci-fi horror with comedic elements, I think. It's very sci-fi because I actually do think that the meta commentary of this, like the meta commentary about technology, seems purposely underbaked, because they touch on it. It's in the movie and it matters, but it never felt like, at least to me, that the unrelenting, like the AI and technology being scary, was like the main thrust of the story or why this movie really exists. And I think that's why the movie actually manages to move with so much energy, because the commentary doesn't slow anything down. We never have to like stop in the middle of everything and be like, and that's why you got to be more careful with technology. Like, it always just felt like it was added flavor to the horror. It was never a meal upon itself, because I do think that they seem to recognize while making this that we already have so many movies about that. And so if you dwell on that too much, I mean, it's just going to raise some red flags for people. Be like, I know how this goes. I know Megan, you know, is scary. Like, let's just get to the parts where Megan are scary. And so that's what I liked about it. It just felt like it was, to borrow a term we've already used, it was self-aware about what the audience's expectations are. And it avoids some of the things that I think the audience is dreading is going to happen.
Yeah, I mean, were you expecting anything like the house kind of coming alive in a way, like with all like the different gizmos and gadgets? And like,
I actually thought that was about to happen, mm-hmm. and then
it never really didn't. Yeah,
yeah, I was like, oh, they're probably going to find a way to bring in like the toys, their right. collectibles and stuff.
And
like,
I
knew that there was something. I know we shouldn't talk too much about stuff mm-hmm. that could get spoilery, but there is something that gets introduced early on in the movie that's like the Chekhov gun of the movie, and I was kind of waiting for that.
That was great. I thought that was fantastic.
I agree. Yeah. I agree. It pulls it off because even in that kind of Chekhov's gun, it still served a function beyond coming back later in the movie. It was something that was a triggering point for something else. And that's how you do that sort of thing, or supposed to do that sort of thing effectively. Again, I just think the screenwriting here is not surprisingly tight, but it is satisfyingly tight.
You know, I mean, I'm not going to say this is like a perfect script, but it's a solid script.
No, but it's
good.
It's very, yeah, it's just got all the juice to it.
Yeah.
You know, it's like, it's not a loosey goosey. It kind of just moves and flows, and it's like, it's what you want from a good script.
Yeah. Cause I mean, I don't know the budget exactly, but I'm guessing it's probably within
$12 million.
I was going to guess probably.
Unbelievable. I thought this would be 20 to 30.
I mean, that's
at least
one of the things.
Man Called Otto. You know how much Man Called Otto cost?
30.
$50 million dollars for A Man Called Otto. You know how many killer dolls are in Man Called Otto? I won't tell you. That'd be a spoiler.
Two.
That'd be more than this one.
Oh, man. Yeah, no. Well, you know, I mean.
Well, yeah, okay. Fair enough.
But no, I mean, I was going to say one of my favorite things about the film was the infusion of like practical and CG effects. Like the effect of Megan is like really well done, especially for a modest budget film like this one. I mean, you know, it's not only fairly seamless, but, you know, just like really practical and efficient. And, you know, it looks, you know, very realistic and knows like when to use CG to make Megan look a little bit more like freaky and uncanny, but also when to use like practical or real effects to either like, you know, make Megan, you know, feel more ingrained and real in a certain scene. Or, you know,
I believe this doll existed.
Yeah.
This is Amy Donald, who is providing the sort of like the practical effect of Megan. Like she's actually like making Megan come alive and everything, like being the doll.
Yeah.
But then we have Jenna Davis voicing the character, and to what you're saying, they do use CGI to kind of round it out. But to me, I thought it was mostly seamless.
Right. So I mean, I think it's just a really well done effect. I feel like it's going to maybe kind of get overlooked because of how seamless it is, but I think it's definitely worth celebrating.
Yeah, it's definitely one of those things where I can imagine like Andy Serkis like watching this movie and just being like, they're learning, you know, like that kind of thing. Critics are obviously liking this one a lot. And I think one of the reasons that critics are liking it if I had it, I think it's because it has a morsel in it for everybody, you know, because like the teens, you know, the preteens, Gen Alpha, Gen Z, whatever you want, they can watch this and just be like, this is goofy, dumb, stupid. I love Megan. Millennials like us can watch it and be like, yeah, parenting is scary. And then like even older adults can watch this and get something out of it too. Like, I think if I had to nail down what I think this movie is getting at, it seems really focused on that same Pixar / Inside Out like storytelling mode of like, hey, it's not a good idea to avoid painful and uncomfortable emotions. Like, you should deal with the imperfections of life head on. And it kind of manifests itself, that emotional undercurrent manifests itself into the characterization, how these characters, like I said before, they're unlikable, but you know, because they're flawed and they're not unlikable in unbelievable ways. And I think that serves how sometimes you're going to be uncomfortable in life. And it's sort of getting at the Allison Williams character feeling like, you know, maybe like, you know, life isn't going to be perfect and she can't always get everything exactly how she wants, but she has responsibilities and there is a way for her to navigate that without relying on the crutch of technology. And I think in this movie, there's that added idea of how technology can be a distraction from what we're really feeling in the world and how we need to express things emotionally. And the movie practically screams this at the audience without being preachy, which is what I like. Like, you're able to get that out of the movie without it just like yelling it at you.
Sure. Yeah, and I mean, I don't know. I guess that's why I didn't really take issue with, like, you were mentioning, like, the toys that, like, were kind of heavily shown throughout. And I felt like they were pretty effective as just, like, little metaphors. Like, she wants everything to be kind of, like, in a box and, like, packaged and, like, efficient. Obviously, life's
not going to be, like... I didn't take issue with the toys.
Well, I thought you... it just sounded like you, like, expected something more, like, story efficient.
Oh, no, I just expected some of them to kind of come into, like, the final thing. And it wasn't something that, like, annoyed me or anything. I was just kind of like,
fine. Everything to be a Chekhov's gun. Some things could just be a metaphor.
It's interesting. Yeah.
Right. Some things could just be metaphors on their own, or symbolism or allegories, whatever you want to call it.
Sure.
Yeah.
Sure. I think, and I do think it serves that sort of thing where, like, it helps establish early on that the Allison Williams character, who I forgot her name. That's why I keep doing this. Gemma. Sorry. So Gemma is like a kid. You know, like, she has these collectibles, she has these toys, and that is effective visual storytelling of like showing the toys and showing how like she's not quite exactly mentally prepared for this. Like, maybe she could be, but she just isn't, because this has sprung on her. And that's how I think a lot of millennials feel like when they hit their mid-30s. And is it obvious to anybody listening to the show that I'm almost in my mid-30s?
I think you're
painfully clear.
I think you're being kind of gradual with it, you know.
Yeah, Will, you're just like seeing me bang a gong that says I'm almost 30. Oh, man. Whatever.
How do you think I feel? I'm gonna be 30 this year. Like, this is my 30th year of life.
I'm not super older than you.
Yeah, I mean, you know, I mean, you think you're the only one here with existential crisis going on? Forget about it.
Yeah, but you've got other movies to wrestle with, I guess.
Yeah, I'll deal with that during our Man Called Auto discussion, I guess.
There you go. Yeah, that's the one. I guess the thing missing for me, though, in this movie is, I think, the progression of Megan herself. I think the character never quite clicked for me beyond all the creepiness. And I am a little worried that they're saving that for like the inevitable sequel. I think the sequel already got greenlit even before the movie came out.
Yeah. I mean, that's that's kind of where I'm getting at. It's that, like, it feels a little prepackaged already, I guess. Like, it kind of feels like they're already kind of expecting this to be a franchise. And I don't know. There's something about
part of that is because this movie is sort of about like making things before they happen. You know, they're like literal scenes where it's like, we're gonna have this press conference. It's gonna be the most popular thing in the world. But, and you're like, am I watching the board meeting for this movie?
I mean, it's effective, but it's also like, it feels a little hypocritical where it's like, it's a movie about like the dangers of this, but it's also like, you can kind of see the gears and mechanisms of Blumhouse being like, all right, this is obviously going to be our next big franchise thing here. And I feel like it was kind of driven home by the fact like their new logo is like, here's all the franchises we have. Remember this thing? And here's Insidious. Here's Michael Myers. Here's, you know, The Purge and all this stuff. And like, I am starting to get a little worried about like, you know, the calculations that go into Blumhouse. Like, I really appreciate the company as like, okay, we're going to shepherd these, you know, genre films. Like, if you can make them for, you know, $10 to $20 million and, you know, we can market them effectively, then hurrah, we'll get into theaters nationwide. But yeah, I mean, obviously it was kind of doomed to be, you know, a franchise starter at some point, because that's just going to how they're going to get, you know, renewing profit. But yeah.
Well, yeah, I mean, it's a slam dunk for them. Like we said before, $12 million budget, $45.7 million box office so far. I mean, come on.
The budget just this opening weekend. Yeah.
Yeah, it's taken off like a rocket ship, and just like they planned it, you know. And I don't know if a sequel will be able to hit the same highs. I don't know. It seems like a bit of a long shot to me in some ways.
They didn't plan one thing though, which is that they already have three in the title for M3GAN. So when they get,
what are they
going
to call the next one? Yeah, M3GAN, the last wish.
Yeah, I mean, what are they going to call the third one? M3GAN
2049.
Yeah, there you go.
Yeah, I think they're going to do something weird with it. Who knows? I even thought, like, when I first saw the title, I was like, well, what were the first two?
Well, I mean,
I'm not joking. I actually thought that. I was like, oh, another one already?
You don't think they're going to do, like, me again? Like, split the M3GAN thing?
You should write in. You know, we should have, like, that same happy death day to you moment.
Yeah. Oh, yeah, yeah. That was, what a moment that was for us.
Yeah. Our fledgling show. Doing its thing. Should we also announce that we hit 1 million downloads? We haven't done that on the air, have we?
Have we not? I thought we did that during like Puss in Boots or whatever.
Maybe we did.
I don't know. You did it on Twitter. I don't know if we actually did it on the air, but yeah,
that's the thing. I'm thinking of when I did it on Twitter, but we hit 1 million downloads. Send Mahalo. Yeah. Thanks for listening.
Yeah, thanks everybody. Yeah, hope you enjoy our conversation.
I think we did talk about it. I think we did mention it.
Yeah, I was gonna say. I thought we did.
Well, you know, for the people who didn't tune in to Puss in Boots: The Last Wish.
Look at us, concerned about the numbers, not even concerned about the product anymore. We're just like...
And that movie is about, like, don't be concerned about the numbers, the selling things. Come on.
Yeah.
Do we learn nothing from these movies?
Yeah, exactly.
All right, I'm ready to play the Rotten Tomatoes game. Unless you had any final thoughts you want to hit on M3GAN. Not hit on M3GAN, but, you know.
I did want to talk a little bit about the two central performances. I mean, obviously, we talked about the actresses that played M3GAN. I thought they both did a very nice job. I really wanted to highlight the main child actress,
Violet McGraw,
who I thought was really good in this. I thought
she was good. She was in Ready Player One.
Yeah. And I thought, you know, she had kind of a tough role where, you know, like you said, you have this very wide-eyed, innocent character, but she's also very emotionally complicated. She's obviously dealing with this horrible tragedy. But, you know, she's not always sympathetic. She's not easy, you know, to, you know, sympathize with every moment because she's a child. And I think she communicates the honesty of a character like this in a way that felt really effective, but didn't undermine the playfulness of the premise.
She's certainly way more memorable than other kids in movies like this. Like the kid in Annabelle. Like any of the kids we've seen in the Annabelle movies. Like I don't really remember them that well. But this one, I have a feeling I will.
Yeah. And then I did really want to talk about Allison Williams because I'm very curious where you stand on her in general and then also what you thought about her performance in this film.
I think she's terrific. I think she's always been really good. Mm-hmm. I think she's a way more self-aware actress than people give her credit for.
Yeah.
I think sometimes people kind of look at her and they just kind of be like, she's not in on the joke. She's in on like what...
Yeah.
Like, I think she knows who she is as an actress and where her strengths are.
Oh, absolutely. And I mean, she's like perfectly cast as Marnie in Girls. I mean, I think that was,
100%.
Extremely well casted performance. And I think she did a great job in that show. I think she's very good in Get Out. And I thought she was good in The Perfection. I feel like her performance in here wasn't like amazing, but I will say that I feel like her performance is key to kind of selling M3GAN as well. The doll, I mean, because like she has to like, you know, kind of be knowing about, you know, this is kind of a goofy premise, silly, but also like sell the honesty of like, okay, you know, like she can't like be, you know, similar to filmmakers, kind of wink, wink, nod, nod, you know, nudge, nudge to the audience. Like, she has to like kind of sell the gravitas of this character such as it is, but also, you know, kind of play into the goofiness of the premise. And I mean, it's a tricky balance. And I think generally speaking, she did a nice job.
Yeah, because I think as I was watching this movie and I was sort of connecting with the character, I was feeling like I know this person. There are people in my life like her who I love to pieces, but I'm always interested like what's really going on in their head. And sometimes they might say something where I'm like, huh, it's a little bit like, it's a little cold, but it's not like overtly cold. You know, like there are certain things she does in this movie where I'm like, man, you are far from perfect. You are far from like the, you know, emotionally like mature. But like, again, that's what makes her so fascinating. It's what makes her human. I think it's what makes you care about her because she does it in a way where like, you certainly, you know, don't look at her as like a role model. Right. And that's part of like what the text of the movie is. Like, this Katie's not supposed to be looking up to her or anything necessarily, but in some ways she should, because she's such a, she's an accomplished human being. She's extremely intelligent. She is caring and she does want to be selfless. Like, part of this movie is that this whole thing doesn't get like saddled onto her outside of her agency. This is something that she agreed to do, and she has a way. I love that the movie gives her a way out. It's like, no, the girl can go stay with, you know, the dad's parents if you want. And she's like, no, I said I was going to do this, so I'm going to do it. And I'm like, that's that millennial, like, I'm going to take this thing on, even though it's not in my job description. And it's little stuff like that where I'm like, Allison Williams sells it.
Yeah, I agree. Yeah. And I also appreciate that, like, we really don't know what's going on with them in Florida. It's just like they're in Florida.
You can fill in the blanks.
And they just keep saying that they're weird. So yeah, it's just it's like, well, I don't know what's going on there, but clearly
you could be charitable too. You can be like, well, it's not great, you know, to uproot a kid that much. Like, mm-hmm. Oregon to Seattle, manageable.
Sure.
Unless you're talking to somebody from those areas, I guess. But like, you know, uprooting from like Oregon all the way to Jacksonville, Florida, that, you know, that's tough, even if you're a big fan of Florida.
Sure. But do you think Megan's going to go to Florida in the sequel?
I hope so. Like, fight a shark.
I was going to say fight a gator. Just like, you know, out in the, yeah.
We start with the gator, then we get to the shark.
Then we get her in Disney World and, you know, it's,
Oh, Disney World Megan. That would be perfect. That would be pretty good. But anything else?
I think that's the gist of it. Yeah, I mean, nothing else is really coming to mind right now. I mean, you know, I think it's just a solid, well-made popcorn horror comedy, sci-fi horror comedy, mm-hmm. like you said. I mean,
really nice start to the year.
Yeah, it's just like a fun little, like you said, surprise. Like, it, I mean, not that I had low expectations going into it, but you know, I was just kind of hoping for the best, expecting the worst. I was like, yeah, this gave me what I wanted. It's exactly what's on the tin, and yeah, it and also in some ways a little bit better. So yeah, can't go wrong with that.
All right, it's playtime.
Sure,
time to play.
Games.
We got our homework done. We did our book report on the movie.
We ate our vegetables.
Now let's just have some fun. Let's play a game.
Yeah.
Rotten Tomatoes game. We have 180 reviews counted. But I will say this, the Rotten Tomatoes score has been changing a lot. And I don't know, because you already warned me. You said I've been swilled on the RT score. Yeah. So you might get this dead on. I don't know. But I have noticed that it shifted a lot. And I'll say what I've seen it kind of shift around as here in a second. Let's start things out. Will Ashton, 180 reviews. What's your best guess for the Rotten Tomatoes score for Megan?
Yeah, I was going to say, I mean, I feel like the score more than most others of late has been really spoiled for me. And I think it's because people are just surprised by how high it's been. Like, they're like, can you believe Megan is blank? Right. Like, can you believe this? Like, is this happening?
They're emailing you the score. They're like, Will, have you noticed this? And then it's like A.O. Scott.
But I mean, initially it was like a 97% or something like that. And I know it's not that.
It started at 98. That was the first official score.
It was at 98 and then I think it went down slightly to 97. But it stayed 97 like through the weekend, I believe. And then it went down a little bit. And last I'd heard earlier today, it was at 94%. And I don't think it really changed. So I'm going to just say it's at 94%.
Smart move. It's harder than it looks because you could have been like, oh, maybe it went down even more. You didn't. You were right. It hasn't changed. It's still 94%. And it is a low enough review threshold where that literally could have changed like a couple points with just a few reviews, right? And I could literally like add a review right now and try to change that just so I could win the Rotten Tomatoes game. I won't do it because that would be dishonest and weird. But anyway.
And petty.
94% though. That's, I mean, when it was at 98%, I was like, that's not going to last. But at the same time, I was like, even just that moment in time, how awesome did the filmmakers have to like get to feel, right?
Yeah.
Like I would just be doing like laps around the pool. That's
You'd
great.
You'd be doing the Megan dance.
I'd be doing the Megan dance, which, you know, not my favorite dance in terms of horror movies, but it's up there.
Yeah, I mean, I guess we didn't talk about the dance that much. Felt a little like prepackaged for the TikTok crowd, but also kind of a fun time. Oh, that was something I was going to mention. Loved every time Megan sang. That made me laugh so hard every single time. I thought it was such a great touch. I love the first time when she like broke out in the song. I thought that was an amazing
decision. Megan a musical.
Yeah. Yeah. When she just like decided to like make the movie a musical for a brief moment. Every time she did that, I thought that was fantastic.
Yeah, we agree there. We agree there. All right, audience score. We have 1,000 plus verified ratings. People showed up, they watched it, and they put their score up. So what do you think it is?
It seems like audiences are digging it. You know, some people in my audience, they were clapping after the film, you know, and
wow,
it wasn't like anyone from the film was working, who worked on the film was there. You know, they just had a good time when everyone's done. So I'm going to say it's a little bit higher, but not like 99% high. I'm going to say 96%.
Unfortunately, Will, the audience score is actually pretty surprising.
Okay.
It's an 80%.
Okay.
I probably would have guessed around the same as you, but yeah, 80%. For some reason, audiences are kind of being a little, they're being a little film critic-y. They're being a little snobby. I don't know.
They're like plot holes.
I don't know. I don't know if it's like an expectation thing. I don't know if it's like, there's nothing about the movie that screams like agenda to me that would like have some sort of like weird online movement against this movie. Like, I just don't see that. Like, what would that even look like?
I mean,
so your guess is as good as mine, honestly.
I know that, Megan and Chucky have been publicly feuding.
There it is. All the Chucky fans are like, this is bull. You know what?
Maybe some of the Chucky stands were coming out and being like, no siree. I don't know Megan.
Yeah, no ma'am.
Yeah, no Megan. Ma'am. Yeah, no ma'am.
All right. What about cinema score? Did you say you got spoiled on this one too?
Nope. This one is going to be an honest to goodness guess because I don't know what it is.
I did get spoiled on it, so I thought maybe you did too. It was kind of all over Twitter. But yeah, what do you think? What's your best guess for cinema score? Now that you know the audience score.
Interesting. I'm tempted to do an A-, but I feel it's closer to a B+. So I'm going to say B+.
You should have kept following your heart even more. It's a B.
B, okay. Okay.
Yeah, isn't that weird?
Yeah.
Maybe this is for the critics, not the fans. I don't know. I'm genuinely shocked. I cannot believe that this seems to be, at least right now, clicking more with critics and film lovers who, you know, are in that world more than, I guess, the general public. I find it kind of interesting.
I mean, it seems like people are liking the film, to be clear. Like, it's not like...
B is not an F, sure. Yeah.
It's not like critics are loving it, audiences are hating it, but... weird sort of divide, at least by those scores. I don't know, but like I said, my audience seemed to dig it, so I can't, I haven't spoken to too many people about the film, but it seems like people are enjoying themselves watching this from what I've seen.
Let's finish out with Letterboxd. We have 50,000 watches as we record this, which is pretty average for a movie like this, but you know, not in a bad way. Average in the sense of like, most movies like that have like a big opening weekend tend to be around like 50,000 or so. So, what do you think the average rating is, 0 to 5, on Letterboxd?
3.7.
It is 3.3.
Oh, okay.
Again, I probably would have guessed around like 3.5. This feels like a very 3.5-star movie for a lot of people who are like, yeah, I like this. I had a lot of fun. Don't like lose your mind over it or anything, but yeah, I guess people are kind of in between the threes and the 3.5s. I'm sure some people are like giving it the 5 stars because they have one life to live and they're not going out, you know, bored. Yeah. So
they're saying she slays, you know, queen, mommy, whatever the terms they want to use to apply to Megan. They're just having fun, like you said.
In terms of friends of the show. You know, I'm seeing, you know, one person gave it 2.5 and that makes it a little sad.
Who was
Corey
that?
Woodruff didn't give it the heart.
Oh
yeah.
Corey about the film.
Isaac Feldberg only gave it 2.5. Yeah. It's not working for everybody. You know, Clint Worthington, though, friend of the show, 3.5 stars.
Sure.
Yeah. Matt Donato, 3.5. Like I said, I feel like 3.5 is like the sweet spot.
Yeah.
Although Kimber Myers gave it 4 stars. Might as well be law.
Sure.
So.
Yeah, I was going to ask you, because the trailer for Knock at the Cabin came on.
It did.
Before my screening of the film, at least. Are we going to have Kimber back on for when we do Knock at the Cabin? That's probably going to be the start of season 7.
That's a good idea.
Yeah.
Yeah, let's hit her up. Let's see if she's available.
Yeah, because you two talked about Old, and I guess fittingly, I have some bones to pick, because I liked that movie, and you two didn't, so... I feel it'd be a good time.
Is the only reason you want to come on?
Well, no. I mean, I haven't talked to Kimber in a long time. I'd really like to talk to her again. But also, I feel like I need to kind of air some grievances as well.
Air out some grievances?
Yeah.
Well, I will warn people that, you know, I didn't really watch the trailer because it looked like it was a new one that gives away more of the plot. So I didn't pay attention to it.
Okay.
For me, it came on after the Missing trailer.
Okay,
The trailer for the movie called Missing.
I didn't get
that. And if that trailer comes on and you're watching M3GAN, avoid it. Mm. It gives away everything. It's the most annoying kind of movie trailer. It made me super mad because I was looking forward to that movie. Now I feel like I just got to skip it. Forget about it. I don't want it.
Yeah, I only got the trailers for Knock at the Cabin and Scream 6, which I hadn't seen the trailer for Scream 6 yet.
Trailer for Scream 6 didn't come on for me. It was Evil Dead Rise.
Oh, I haven't seen that one
Renfield.
Yet. I haven't seen that one yet.
Ant-Man Quantumania for some reason.
I've seen that one plenty of times.
Sure. That was only my second time seeing that one. Because the only other time I saw it was Avatar.
Okay.
And I can usually trust Marvel. Like, I feel like they hide things pretty well in their movies. But yeah, no. The one for Missing came on and I was so mad. I mean, it's from the people who made Searching. So I was really looking forward to it. Now I feel like I can just skip it.
Yeah, I was trying to figure out. So it's not like a sequel or anything to Searching, right?
No, it's like a spiritual like sequel / spinoff. It's like the same kind of format. It's Screen Life. So it's like found footage, but only through screens. Mm. It's just great trailer programming for this M3GAN movie, sure.
Sure.
But seriously, like they give away so much. I genuinely was just like, do you want us to watch the movie? Mm. You know, like who is watching that and be like, I got to see it. It's like,
I will say... I just got the original teaser for Knock at the Cabin, which I think is a great teaser. I hope you...
It's great. Yeah. And that's the one to watch. Like, don't watch the other few trailers.
The official trailer,
I guess, could tell they were getting more into the stuff. I was like, I don't want to know that.
Yeah, that's what I mean. So I love the teaser because it just tells me just enough. Like, I don't want to know more until I get that ticket and see the movie for myself, baby.
Same here. Yeah. Same here. But we're not the people they're targeting. They're targeting people who they need their hands held, paired. Sure. With the movie, you know, they have to be the primary user, I guess.
I guess so. That was trailer talk.
That was it. That was our very rare trailer talk. I can't remember the last time we talked about trailers. But anyway, that'll do it for this week's episode of Cinemaholics. A bit of a short one, but I think worth it. And we'll be back next week to talk about, I think next week's going to be our best movies of the year episode.
What are you talking about? We're not covering Plane?
I am going to see Plane tomorrow, weather permitting.
Did you see that trailer?
I have seen that trailer.
Okay, I was going to say, Plane, when I saw that trailer during Black Adam, and I don't mean to delay this episode ending, but that trailer was one of the highlights of the end of the year for me.
I had no idea where this like was going to go, where you were going to go with this.
I didn't, I had no idea what that trailer was going to be. I just was like, oh, Gerard Butler's in a new movie. What's this going to be? And then that trailer unfolded. And I wish I could have gone, you know, longer without knowing the title. But, like, I didn't know the title when I saw the trailer. And then the reveal of the title, Plane, hardest laugh I've had in a long, long time. Fantastic.
It was
trailer.
The timing was impeccable.
Yeah.
It reminds me, too, of, like, remember... I don't know if you ever feel this way, but I've had that anxiety of like watching trailers for a movie and feeling like I'm so jazzed up for these trailers that when the actual movie comes on, it feels like a bummer. It's like, instead.
To be clear, I'm not expecting Plane to be anything more than a trashy good time, if that.
But sometimes trailers are a little too fun. I don't know. Yeah. I mean, that used to be more of a thing. Now it's not. But like, I remember that was more of a thing when I was like a teenager. Extended trailer talk.
But so we're not doing Man Called Otto for the next review. That's going to be a bonus thing you're talking about.
We could do a bonus. We just did our bonus of The Whale. If you missed that on the feed, and because we got to get to our best of the year. We don't want to wait too long, right?
I guess so. Yeah, I like to delay it personally because I try to catch up on stuff. But you know, I accept that I just can't catch up on everything. We just got to kind of rip the Band-Aid off and get it going.
Hey, we have Critics' Choice voting this week, and I'm trying to squeeze stuff in. You know, I still got to see Argentina 1985, and it's tough. It's tough. But yeah, we can't see everything. We'll do our best to watch what the listeners are interested in. So as always, hit us up directly if there's anything we miss, and we'll do our best to cover it.
Sounds good.
Yeah. Cool. All right. Well, that'll be it from us this week from the Internet California. I'm John Negroni.
And for the Internet Pennsylvania, I'm Wes.
See you next time.